For the last 130 days, this bowl has been doing exactly what a healthy ecosystem is supposed to do. Nothing dramatic, nothing impressive at first glance. Just water, light, and time. This ecosystem began as a simple glass bowl filled with water from the Neckar River in Germany. No filters, no pumps, no artificial balance. From day one, the goal wasn't to control it, but to observe what happens when nature is left alone. And for the most part, nature prefers to move slowly. Over the past 4 months, algae bloomed and then disappeared again. Microorganisms exploded in number and quietly stabilized. Snails multiplied, grazed, and kept the glass clean without ever knowing they were doing maintenance. What looks calm on the surface is actually constant work beneath it. Bacteria breaking down waste, microcrustaceans recycling nutrients, and plants regulating oxygen and light. In closed ecosystems like this, stability doesn't mean nothing happens. It means thousands of small processes happen at the same time, perfectly out of sync, yet somehow balanced. And that balance is fragile, not because it's weak, but because it's precise. After 130 days, this bowl has reached a point ecologists call dynamic equilibrium. The animals and microorganisms aren't frozen in time. They're constantly adjusting to each other. Every population rise is answered by a population fall somewhere else. That's why I rarely interfere. Every hand in the water is a disturbance. Every small change has consequences that only show days or weeks later. Up until today, the biggest predators in this bowl were snails. Slow, predictable, and mostly harmless. And that's exactly why everything worked. But ecosystems don't stay the same forever. They either adapt or they collapse. And today, for the first time in 130 days, I decided to change something. Not by accident, not by neglect, but intentionally. Because sometimes the only way to understand balance is to disturb it. Before anything new enters the bowl, I have to disturb what's already there. Over time, minerals from the water have slowly settled on the glass. Lime scale, a quiet reminder that even a living system, chemistry never sleeps. I remove it carefully, using nothing more than an unused sponge. No detergents, no shortcuts. In ecosystems like this, even a trace of soap would be enough to undo months of balance. What looks like cleaning is really just restoring visibility. For me, not for the animals. Once the deposits are gone, I wipe the inside and outside of the glass with a microfiber cloth. Slowly, deliberately, every moment creates small currents, tiny disturbances the animals immediately respond to. This is the paradox of observation. To see clearly, you first have to interfere. And then comes the real change. These animals didn't come from a store. They didn't come from a lab. They were already part of this ecosystem. Just somewhere else. All summer long, I used an abandoned plant pot as a rainwater collector. It was left untouched. No fish, no filtration. Just water, light, and tons of Amazon frogbit growing on its surface. Over months, it turned into a miniature wetland of its own. And life found it. Inside a simple white transport container, I take a closer look at it. Mayfly nymphs. Built for grazing and drifting, spending most of their lives underwater before ever seeing air. Copepods, almost invisible but essential, the link between algae and everything larger. And a single bloodworm, bright red, full of energy and already part of the food web. And then a dragonfly larva, compact, armored, ancient. Dragonflies have existed for over 300 million years, and their larvae still carry that history in their design. They are ambush predators, perfectly adapted for still water, capable of striking faster than the eye can follow. It's been almost 3 months since that bowl last had an animal like that. When I pour them into the ecosystem, I don't place them, I release them. No slow drip, no rearranging, just gravity, water, and instant taking over. Almost instant, I acclimated them for about an hour to the new water parameters before. Some animals disappear immediately into the plants, others sink to the bottom and freeze, assessing their new world. At this moment, nothing looks dramatic. No chasing, no hunting, a little chaos, but ecosystems don't react instantly. They remember. and the consequences of this moment won't show right away. They'll reveal themselves when food appears. By the time I'm ready to feed the bowl, something else has happened. All the movement from before, the cleaning, the added animals, the subtle currents, has lifted fine debris from the sand and plants. It settles down on the inside of the glass, just like dust after a storm. So I reach for my most advanced, multifunctional, high-tech precision tool. An old toothbrush. Carefully, I clean only the front section of the glass. Not because the animals need it, but because we do. In ecosystems like this, visibility decides what we think is happening, not what actually is happening. Some debris still clings to the sand. I use a pipette to gently flush it away, sending tiny clouds back into the water column. Particles drift, dust settles again. And then, finally, I add food. Just a quarter of a catfish pellet, the same kind I normally feed to my corridoras. I place it directly against the glass and wait. Nothing happens. No sudden movement. No rush. No interest at all. For a long moment, the pellet just sits there, slowly softening, releasing scent into the water. The debris continues to fall. Life seems almost indifferent. This is something we often forget about aquatic animals. They don't react to sight the way we do. They react to chemistry, to time, to patience. And then, a flash of red, far in the back of the bowl, right at the edge of visibility, something moves, slowly, purposefully. Who is this animal, lurking so far back in such a small world? It's Gordon Ramsay. Gordon Ramsay II, to be precise. The Ramshorn snail. It took him nearly 20 minutes to detect a pellet. 20 minutes for scent molecules to travel, for receptors to register, for a decision to be made. And once he knows, there's no hesitation. He moves straight towards the food and begins to eat. Not aggressively, not greedily, methodologically. Using his radula, a rasp-like structure lined with thousands of microscopic teeth, Gordon scrapes away at the pellet, turning solid food into edible particles. It's slow work, precise work. At this point, he's still alone. A few smaller snails approached. Some copepods hover nearby, picking up whatever escapes the main meal. But there's no competition yet. In real time, this looks almost uneventful. That's why we speed up the footage 50 times now. And suddenly, you can see it, the dedication, the rhythm, the quiet efficiency of an animal that has evolved to never waste energy. Gordon Ramsay II doesn't rush food. He works it. And while all eyes are on him, something else is happening in the background. Something that hasn't revealed itself yet. Because in this bowl, food doesn't just attract grazers, it attracts predators. Before we get to what happens next, if you enjoy these slow ecosystem experiments and want to support them directly, you can join the Tetra Gang or the Guppy Gang with a monthly membership. It helps keep projects like this running. And no worries if you cannot support this way. Let's see what happens in the video next. If you look closely at the right side of the screen, something enters the frame. Slow at first, almost hesitant, the dragonfly larva. At first, I assume it's here for the pellet. That would make sense. Food this concentrated doesn't exist naturally in ecosystems like this. But instead of going for the pellet, it rushes Gordon. Not to eat him, but to confront him. For a brief moment, both animals abandon the food entirely. Pellet lies untouched next to them, while the dragonfly larva positions itself directly in Gordon's path. This isn't feeding behavior. This is territorial behavior. Dragonfly larvae are ambush hunters. In the wild, they spend hours, sometimes even days, motionless in the sediment, waiting for prey to come close enough. The typical targets are mosquito larvae, small worms, water fleas, and even tiny fish if the opportunity arises. They don't chase food. they wait for it. Gordon, on the other hand, lives a completely different life. Ramshorn snails survive on scarcity. Thin layers of biofilm, microscopic algae, organic residue spread across surfaces. That's why Gordon is almost always eating. Not because he's greedy, but because his food is basically everywhere and nowhere at the same time. This palette changes everything. For the first time, both animals are drawn to the same object, a single dense source of nutrients, and for a moment, neither seems quite sure what to do with that. Then Gordon returns, more focused than before, hungrier, undeterred. In the 50x sped up footage, you can see it clearly now. The dragonfly larva pushes forward and buries itself partially under the pellet, anchoring its position. Gordon responds by doing what he does best, scraping, absorbing, collecting every particle that breaks free. Two completely different feeding strategies. One resource. The larva waits, adjusting, occasionally repositioning. Gordon never stops, and slowly, almost imperceptibly, the balance shifts. After about 30 minutes, the dragonfly loses interest. Whether the pellet doesn't behave like prey or simply isn't worth the effort anymore, it retreats back into the substrate. Gordon stays. And in this tiny confrontation, Gordon wins. When I zoom in from this angle, something incredible becomes visible. Through the ramshorn snail's translucent shell, you can see its internal organs moving, the digestive tract in motion, and possibly his heart beating. This is what I love about ecosystems like this. No dramatic battles, no clear villains or heroes, just animals being exactly what millions of years of evolution shaped them to be. And sometimes the slowest one wins. The feeding doesn't end with Gordon. A little later, more guests arrive. Bladder snails begin to appear, drawn in by what's left behind. They are close relatives of ramshorn snails. Similar lifestyles, similar diets, but despite that, the two species can't interbreed. Evolution drew that line a long time ago. They move quickly, cleaning up the remaining fragments. In ecosystems like this, nothing goes to waste for long. And while they work, I'm reminded that this bowl isn't just an observation project. It's actually part of a small breeding experiment I'm doing together with Matt from Matt Keeps Fish, another YouTube channel you should absolutely check out if you're interested in naturalistic aquariums and behavior-driven setups. Gordon, the ramshorn snail, has been in this bowl for at least 70 to 80 days now. Can't recall exactly for how long. Ramshorn snails are often believed to reproduce on their own. They are hermaphrodites and in theory capable of self-fertilization. If that were fully true, this bowl should be full of baby snails by now, but it isn't, which quietly suggests something important. Self-reproduction might be possible, but not efficient. And even in the simplest ecosystems, biology rarely follows shortcuts. And then, almost as an afterthought, I notice something new, right there on the glass. At first, it looks like nothing, just a faint outline, a soft distortion against the green background of plants and algae. But when the light hits it just right, it becomes clear. A freshwater limpet. Unlike snails like Gordon or the bladder snails, limpets don't carry a visible spiral shell. Their shell is shaped more like a tiny, flattened dome, smooth, transparent, and perfectly pressed against the glass. From certain angles, it almost disappears completely. Freshwater limpets are gastropods, just like ramshorn snails and bladder snails, but they've taken a different evolutionary path. Instead of roaming surfaces freely, they cling tightly to hard substrates and graze on biofilm and microalgae. They're slow, extremely unobtrusive, and very, very easy to miss, which is probably why I've never seen one in this bowl before. Their presence tells a quiet story. Limpets usually appear only once an ecosystem has matured enough to provide stable surfaces, consistent biofilm growth, and long-term balance. I didn't edit. I didn't plan for it. It was here, waiting for the right moment to be noticed. And that might be the most important lesson this bowl keeps teaching us. The longer you watch, the more it reveals. Not through action, but through patience. Because in healthy ecosystems, the most interesting animals aren't always the loudest, the fastest, or the most aggressive. Sometimes they are the ones that have been there all along, quietly holding everything together. Before we end this video, a big thank you to my guppy. A big thank you to my guppy gang members for supporting the channel. Belgium Bucks, JVP, Dotty, and Julius. Your support genuinely helps make videos like this possible. And if you'd like to see how this ecosystem started, you'll find the video on the right-hand side. That's the very beginning of this bowl. Or on the left, you'll find my latest video. Thanks for watching.